What a week it's been. Another big week in R&B, but for all the wrong reasons. Welcome to this special edition of The Late Lit with me, Trevor Nelson. This show's devoted to the R&B singer Aaliyah, who tragically died on Saturday the 25th of August at 6:05 when a Cessna 402 light aircraft carrying her to Miami crashed in the Bahamas. The cause of that crash is still being investigated. Eight others died in the incident, and our thoughts go out to all the families concerned. This special will look back at the short but brilliant career of the Princess of R&B, Aaliyah. Aaliyah had been shooting a video for Rock the Boat, the third single from her recently released third album with director Hype Williams. It was the first time they had worked together, even though they had been friends for 6 years. She was only 22 at the time of her death, but as mentioned, she had produced three successful albums and was building her reputation as an actress. Her first break in the music business came at the age of 15 with her 1994 debut album, Age Ain't Nothing But a Number. Produced by R. Kelly, the album went platinum. Let's take a look at how Aaliyah's career got started.
As soon as I carried a tune, and I started doing plays and performing around my home area. Got into the profession at 9, had agents in New York, and did auditions for TV pilots and things like that. Did Star Search. And at 12 is when I got my deal. My uncle got a joint venture with Jive for his label, and I auditioned for Jive, and he signed me, and that's how I came out at 14. My favorite track on the album is At Your Best You I Love. Well, recording that song was fun because I had time ahead of time to listen to the song and learn it. So when I went to the studio, I knew what I was going to sing, and it was a lot easier for me, which was cool because I love the Isley Brothers. So I took the time out to really get into it and know it before I recorded it. And the video was cool because it was all at night, nighttime video. It was a lot of fun. I had a lot of kids around involved in it. My brother's in all three of my videos, so you know, being with him was cool. It's a lot of fun doing it.
Aaliyah was born Aaliyah Dana Horton on January the 16th, 1979 in Brooklyn, New York. Her name in Arabic means the highest and most exalted one. Her parents Diane and Michael nurtured her daughter's talent, introducing her to many of the soul greats such as Marvin Gaye, Isley Brothers and Stevie Wonder. In fact, her aunt is the legendary Gladys Knight, and she performed with Gladys at the age of 11. She started her career playing parts in school plays and attending auditions for television sitcoms. We met up with Aaliyah in London last year in June, and she spoke about those early days.
It's 7 years you've been in this business now, more or less.
Wow, yeah.
Well, 7 years as a recording artist.
Yeah.
You're a real veteran at 21. You're a vet. So, I mean, the excitement of you and your first album was massive. I mean, your first track, your first hit, Back and Forth. So Back and Forth was your first hit.
Back and Forth was the first single,
awesome,
yeah.
Awesome record. How much did it change your life? I mean, what a change of life for you. What happened? How did you find the industry, the business? Was it scary?
It was intimidating at first, but it's something I've been around since I was a little girl. My family is an entertainment family, and so it was something I was always privy to, which helped. But of course, when you're out there and everything is on you, it's something to get used to. So, but it was everything I expected it to be. My family sat me down and told me what it was going to be like and how much responsibility and how much work it was going to be. So I was definitely prepared for it, but it just felt good to come out and have people accept and love me right off the bat like that.
Did you feel at any point that, you know, the grind, because there is a promotional grind as well when you're that young, did you feel that some of your childhood was passing you by, or did you really care?
I don't feel like I missed out on anything. I've always been an old soul, very mature, and I've always pushed my parents for this, and this was always top priority. So I loved going out and traveling and working. And when I came home, I went to school, I went to parties, I had my Sweet 16, I went to my prom, so I have those memories. And I make the time to just kick it and be young. And then when it's time to work, it's time to work. So I don't think I missed out on anything.
My glam squad, Eric, and Daryl. They're my dream team. Eric Farrell is my makeup artist.
Oh, my pores, it's like all in my pores.
I never have to worry with Eric. I close my eyes, open them, and he makes me beautiful. Eric Foreman does my hair. Keeps it healthy, keeps it gorgeous. The gorgeous, the doll, and gorgeous.
I have a favorite toy. He's so much fun. It's just, you dress him up and...
This is my favorite one right here.
Look. Okay.
You can do this.
We have these little play mics that he bought from his toy store, and we take them everywhere with us. We just literally act a fool, and I love it. It's like being a kid. And sometimes you need that. Sometimes you need to just be pure silly.
The success of Age Ain't Nothing But a Number thrust Aaliyah into the limelight to such an extent that every relationship or public appearance was heavily scrutinised, none more so than the alleged relationship with R. Kelly. We all know the rumours of the supposed marriage and the annulment of that marriage, but the aftermath of scandal sent her on tour, and more importantly was a catalyst to her changing label and producer. In part two, we delve into her second album, and we find out about her working relationship with Timbaland.
Childhood nicknames. One is Baby Girl. My father gave that to me when I was born. He said I have a beautiful baby girl, and that one stuck with me. A lot of people still call me Baby Girl. Lily is another one. That was also a family nickname, short for Aaliyah. A few of my friends call me Lily. And a few of my friends in high school, I went to Foreign Arts High School, called me Lala. Saying La La La. Cute, right? So those are my three nicknames.
Welcome back to the second part of our Late Lick Aaliyah tribute. In this part of the show, we'll be looking at Aaliyah's second album, One in a Million. Timbaland carried the main production duties with his trademark bass lines and percussive beats, layered with Aaliyah's featherlight angelic vocal. One in a Million went double platinum in 10 months and was laced with hits like Four Page Letter, Hot Like Fire, and If Your Girl Only Knew.
I'm so
is my baby. It still is. It's just something about that song. When I first heard it, it just touched me in a place, and I can't explain really what it is, but just lyrically and everything, it just touched me, and I when I hear it today, I still close my eyes and get into it. So that's my baby.
Now, one of the most important influences in Aaliyah's career was Tim Mosley, aka Timbaland. They hooked up for the first time on the One in a Million project, but they'd known each other for years. Here she is talking about that special relationship.
We're very close. We have a wonderful friendship outside of the work relationship, and we just click. And he knows me like the back of his hand, and I know him like the back of my hand. So it's like, I think that's why the work comes out so great. He knows that I'm gonna try things that other people probably wouldn't try. I'm a risk taker, and I'm always for staying on the cutting edge. And he's an innovator, so if he has like the craziest, sickest track, he knows he can give it to me, and I'm gonna go for it. So we have a lot of fun together. It's a very tight-knit family, Missy, player, Tim and all of us. So.
Yeah, you've collaborated with the whole family, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of love shared out there.
Oh, yeah, we're tight. We're tight.
And, I mean, but with someone like Timbaland, who is working with all these other artists, what about when it comes to your album? Does he have to schedule it 12 months in advance? Because you don't want to get to a situation where you're phoning up, Tim, what's happening? I'm ready for my album. I'm busy. You know, does that ever happen? I mean, is it like that?
No, we make time for each other. Yeah. What Tim is like, when it's time for Baby Girl, that's it. Mm-hmm. Everything is put to the side, and it's time for her. And the same with him. He can call me anytime I'm going to drop what I'm doing. And we just did a song before I came out here. Called me and I was there for him, so we're a priority for each other, which is cool.
She's like blood, and I lost blood, you know what I'm saying? It's a,
her creativity is so, me and her together had this chemistry that I feel like I kind of lost half of my creativity side. You know, it's kind of hard for me to really get up and talk to the fans right now, but I feel like they need to know, you know, that beyond the music, she is a brilliant person. She's like the specialist person that I've probably ever met.
Promotion schedule of One in a Million. She decided to take time out before her next album, but always a workaholic, Aaliyah accepted offers to contribute on soundtracks in the interim. Tracks on the Anastasia soundtrack and Dr. Dolittle were unforgettable.
Dr. Dolittle is very important because it was a highlight in my career. It was one of the biggest songs of 98 for me, and it was just a great video, great song. Journey to the Past, that was a really great soundtrack for me because I got a chance to see the movie before I did it, and I like animated features, so I was excited about that one. And also because that song went to the Oscars, that definitely meant a lot. Or how a road can
seem so long. The natural progression for Aaliyah after working on soundtracks was of course to star in movies herself, which she did in 1999 in a hip-hop action flick, Romeo Must Die.
Trish O'Day is, she's a sweet girl, but she's very edgy, very independent, and she's tough, take control kind of girl. And she doesn't take anything up of anybody, you know, so I really like about her. She's quick to lose control and say whatever she wants, which is not like me, but I liked playing that. It was fun to kind of be crazy like that.
Look at here. Man, can you believe this? What the hell is she doing? Hey, what's up, Trish?
What's up, Silk?
Let's talk.
Bye. Come on.
Your pops has been running around like Donald Trump, grabbing up every roll up in here on me.
To finally make the transition into acting, it was great. Very happy. I just feel very blessed to be part of such a great project with a great cast, and for my first time to have such a great role. It's a big part, and it's a good movie.
Check this out. We can't get this game started because we're a man short. You'd like to help us out? Besides, Trish loves football players, don't you, Trish?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Right on.
I'm gonna give you the ball, and you run to the far end of the field. Got it?
That's all?
That's all. Right.
Right.
Right. Right. Okay.
Hey, yo. You know what a dog needs. And I'm a finish.
Yeah. This album, Romeo Must Die, is by far the best soundtrack this year, anyway. And there seems to be a lot more effort. I saw Destiny's Child recently and I spoke about their track, which I like on the album as well. Yeah. Did you actually, you executive produced this album, so?
Yeah.
What was the process in putting the soundtrack together?
Well, I just helped in choosing the artists and picking the songs. I wanted Destiny's Child on the soundtrack, I love them. And just some of my favorite artists I wanted on the soundtrack. And we wanted it to be multicultural to match the film. So we put a lot into it. It was something that we wanted to make the whole project big. And we knew before we shot the movie that we were going to put a lot into the soundtrack. Joel was involved. It was a major, major effort.
What would you do to get to me? What would you say to have your way?
After the success of Romeo Must Die, Aaliyah went on to star in the upcoming vampire movie, Queen of the Damned, and had started preparing for a major role in The Matrix 2 and 3, and she no doubt would have gone on to become a major movie star. In part three, we'll look at her third and final album, which came out in July 2001, which has already nearly sold 500,000 copies in the UK alone. See you after the break.
Okay.
It's not that bad. You know, all kids do bad stuff in school. One time in school, I was a really good student, mind you. I have to preempt it with that. But what was I, in the sixth grade or something? And I got a progress report. Was it a progress report? Was it my report card? It was one of those, a test or something like that. And I was devastated that I got a C, because I always had A's and B's, and I didn't like it, and I did not want to take it home to show that I got a C. So I changed it to a B, and my mom never knew that I got a C on my report card instead of a B. I erased it. I don't know how I did it, but I worked out somehow, and I, hey. So, you know, God forgive me, I'm sorry. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do.
Welcome back to our Late Lick Aaliyah tribute. In this part, we'll be bringing her short but glittering career up to date. Her third album, which was self-titled, came 5 years after One in a Million and was a very personal project because its dark and brooding undertones was a reflection of a side of her personality which is rarely seen. Here is Aaliyah taking us through the making of the album.
The new album is self-titled, and I wanted to self-title it because I feel this one is really me. It's the Aaliyah that my fans know, you know, from Age Nothing But a Number to One in a Million to now. You know, that signature style will always remain, but this album is a bit more mature. I'm a young adult now, I'm 22 years old, and I think that's really evident on this album. It's got a lot of different flavors, a lot of different styles on it. We fused the hip-hop and R&B with a bit of rock on some of the songs, a bit of Latin, a little bit of jazz. So it's got a little bit something for everybody. So I wanted to be able to please the masses. So I'm hoping that my fans are with me on this one. There are a few songs that are very dark, but that's a major part of my personality. Some songs call for a bit of power, so you feel the growth, not only just in me as a person and emotionally, but even vocally. So to me, this is my best work to date, and I hope my fans agree. The movie is actually along the album. I started working on this third album before I did Romeo, but then when that project came up, I took a break from it to do Romeo Must Die and to do that soundtrack. So I took a conscious break before, you know, starting to record, because I wanted to take a break for myself to rejuvenate and just get my creative juices flowing and to feel like I could give my audience my best. But then the other projects came up. So that's what really pushed the album back even further. So when I did Queen of the Dam, I decided to record the album at the same time so that I could release the album this year.
The first few weeks after the release of the album, it's very important. Every day will be jam-packed.
The last time my next guest was on the show, she scared the crap out of me with her pet snake.
I'm gonna see what clothes Derek got. I hope he got me something cute. If not, I'll be wearing this.
The album comes out, got a lot of in stores. Go back to TRL. I always have fun at TRL.
Please say hi to Aaliyah.
It's good to see the fans outside in Times Square. Posters that they make. And Carson's great.
All right, how are you? It's good to see you.
I'm good. It's good to see you, too.
The record's out today, self-titled.
Yes,
congratulations.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm really excited.
MTV's always fun. It's a kind of play around and be free and be silly.
All three
of you guys.
We got to breathe in.
Bring the curtain around.
In the midst of working, I know how to have fun.
Oh, let's see.
Who's that? Is that all of us?
Mm-hmm.
All of that.
I got one more, just me about myself. See, I needed my own fellowship without people's hats and glasses all in my... I'm just
you should enjoy your job. You should wake up every day and love what you do. I honestly do from the bottom of my heart to the depth of my soul.
Leaving now, going to the in-store for loads of fun. For loads of fun.
So there we have it, Aaliyah, a 22-year-old starlet, a singer and actress with everything to live for. She was without doubt one of a small band of artists that garnered universal love, not just for her music, but for what she represented as a strong, black, independent and multi-talented woman. And I've met most of these R&B singers around, and Aaliyah left a definite impression on me, somebody who was always in control of her career, very beautiful and destined for great things. We're going to miss her. I'm still reeling with shock, just as you probably are. Aaliyah, the Lick salutes you.
Every day was a special event, like whether it was going to the store or going to a movie and just sitting in the house. We just, you know, wherever we was, it was like our own little party. We were in our own little world. And I loved her with all my heart. I was going to marry her.
So you guys made a plan to be married?
Yeah, we were definitely going to get married. As soon as she had time, we were getting married. Mm-hmm. Like after the Matrix. We had discussed it with anybody, but in our personal plans. It's just that both our lives, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, whether she was always doing something or I was always doing something, and that was what was painful. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, the minute we could spend a month or two or three straight, we were definitely going to get married. And, you know, we were together for over a year. I never raised my voice to her. I never had an argument with her. We never argued about anything because it just, there was nothing to argue about. I would do anything for her, mm-hmm. anything to protect her from any kind of pain.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, she became one of my family. She was my family. She was my best friend. And she was the closest person to me. Mm-hmm. So my heart is broken. Trust.
I just always believe that, If the chance came back around, we would work well together. We grew to be friends outside of working.
You truly do enjoy every aspect of that life. And there are mornings when I'm tired and I don't want to get up and, you know, deal with some of the things you have to deal with in the industry, working all day long, but then just like today, you know, interviewing with you and doing things that we've done, you know, I had a lot of fun. So when you really do love something from your heart, you really do enjoy it. And I really love my life. I have good friends, good family. I wake up every day and I work doing something I love. So there's nothing better than that. I truly am happy. I cannot complain at all. That would totally be ungrateful.